Gilded Darkness by Nari World is the new exhibition by the Nicola Trussardi Foundation. As always, we rediscover forgotten or hidden places in the cities of Milan and invite artists to intervene in these very charged and unusual spaces. And this time, Nari World has conceived an incredible gesture in the pool. It's a complex of buildings that dates from the 1930s, actually 1920s, a very beautiful mixture of metaphysical architecture and rationalist and modernist architecture. And in the giant pool, which is 100 meters by 40 meters, Nari stages this piece, which is called Emergence Pool, which is composed by 2,000 emergency blankets that float on the surface and gently move in the breeze. Throughout the show, there are other 8 interventions. Some are existing pieces, some historical, very important pieces like Amazing Grace. There are 3 new productions, and so it's both a survey and an intervention in a very unusual architectural and urban space. Nari World emerged in the 1990s, is I think one of the most interesting artists who have imagined and transformed contemporary art. On one end, conceiving contemporary art as a truly multicultural and multilinguistic complex of words and languages and materials. Nari is an exceptional weaver of stories and weaver of materials. This could be described as a giant carpet, and if you look at Amazing Grace, you'll see how the strollers are woven together. So on one end, Nari really imagined a multicultural view of contemporary art, which in the 1990s was still quite radical and hopefully now is quite common. And secondly, his biggest contribution is the shift from sculpture to installation. I think Nari is one of the first artists in the 1990s who conceives of art as theatrical, to use an overused term, immersive experiences. So conceives a sculpture not as a single object around which the visitor circles, but rather sculpture as an omnicomprehensive and multimedia spectacle that surrounds the viewer. As every exhibition, it's a dialogue between artworks, but what I think makes the exhibitions of the Trussardi Foundation more exceptional is the dialogue between the site and the artworks. The old changing rooms have been closed for decades. It's the first time that the public can go in, and it's a space that it's rich with amazing stratifications and association. It's a place full of almost ghosts with these coat hangers and so on. And Nari disseminates both material and immaterial presences. And then here you have this giant monument, if you will. I think the exhibition is actually also a reflection on monumentality. This place was built in the 20s to celebrate certain ideas, certain myths of athletism and nationalism and imperialism. And to these ideas, Nari replies with a notion of monumentality that is precarious, that is fragile, that is impermanent. All concepts that have certainly defined the 21st century, as much as those myths, which are also dangerous myths, that they were very much connected to racism, had pervaded the previous century.
Combination of duress, but also of a kind of presence, maybe even the presence of emerging. The interesting thing about this material is it's used normally for crisis, when somebody, the body is in crisis, something has happened and there needs to be a way to control the temperature. But it's also when somebody's decided they want to run a marathon or some sport events, they'll put it around their body to, again, equalize their temperature. So there's something about options that was really interesting for me, right? Having options and not having options. I initially came to the idea of the gold because the namesake of the building is Guido Romano, who is a gold medalist. from sort of the fascist era. He died in World War One, and so this was a kind of memorial to him when he passed away that the fascist regime created. So I also wanted to think about gold as a kind of memorial element, but not gold as in like value and power, but create a gold that was more about vulnerability and maybe even light, thinking about the light more than the weight. So ultimately it's all just like Amazing Grace. It's about how can a space of vulnerability bring the viewers together, that sort of allow for kind of collective dialogue with. In Amazing Grace, which is a work I did in 1993, I really wanted the strollers to create the world, the environment, the space for the viewer. And I wanted to, being a, you know, I'm a storyteller, so I really wanted it to be a kind of epic story or presentation of a story. And so I needed as many as possible, and so I would go out every day and collect them. So in the end, I decided I needed 365. I had to find a number that made sense for a full year. So there's roughly that amount of strollers there. So the ones inside are linked. So there's two dialogues. There's the inside grouping, which are linked and bound together with fire hose, the skin of the fire hose, the outside layer of the fire hose. And I kind of thought it would look like umbilical cords, mm-hmm. And that they were somehow connected, but also in a state of maybe crisis. And then the ones on the outside are more like witnesses. Mm-hmm. They're kind of just looking at the moment that's happening inside. And then the viewers is a kind of accomplice. They're asked to walk in between those two spaces, two realities. I wanted it always to be hope. And this song, Amazing Grace, is a song of hope, right? It's a song of transformation and agency over your life and faith. So I that was essential to have that playing while the viewer is navigating the space.